Good evening, friends. You may be seated. We most certainly deem this a grand privilege to be here tonight in the service of Christ. We wish to thank all you fine people here in the Grand Prairie for this lovely time of fellowship. We shall never forget it. Trusting that if it's God's will that I could get back again sometime to be with you, perhaps with a longer stay. It's kind of a flyby night that our brother got the information and they made ready right quick for our coming. Did not have time to advertise it. And I've been mostly rude to keep you farmer people up so late at night, knowing your plowing season and things is at hand now. So I'm sorry that I held you up, but I hope that something was said or done that'll last through eternity for you. I certainly want to thank the pastor, all these fine cooperating pastors here that come in. I'm so glad that you people have pastors like this, that shepherds over the flock of Christ. Now, trusting that the meeting, the results will be long-lasting with you, that you'll never forget the visit of our Lord. I was sorry to come to you so tired and worn out, but as you know, I was on my way up for a little time of fishing and hunting with some friends up at Dawson Creek, and I just been 6 months on the field without stopping, so I'm really worn out. The meetings has nothing like being what they should have been, because the first vision or two, then I'm just gone. And anyone knows that in a regular meeting, sometimes it's 30 or 40 of them in a night. And so it's because I've been so tired, not because of your faith. Another thing, I think, if we had an instruction service to let the people know, many of them, it's new to them. When the Holy Spirit, when you're praying, you be praying and remembering that God's fixed to answer your prayer right then. And as soon as it speaks, you rise. That's quickly. That God wants you to move real quick, see, and rise to it. I know it's many times I'd see the vision over someone, and then I'd speak, and if they don't respond to it, it moves right over to someone else, you see. And then very timid the Holy Spirit is. It'll move. Maybe that person sitting there with good faith believing, that would help them a little. It will not heal them. It doesn't heal them, but it gives them confidence to know that their prayer touched the high priest. And sometimes that way they miss it by not knowing just how to take a hold of it. It's something new. And it's not no more than what your pastor or anyone else would pray for you. Because after all, it's just the prayer of faith that saves the sick. The pastor has just as much right to pray for you as anyone there is. And if your pastor is not there, a good saintly person in the neighborhood, anyone. Because confess your faults one to the other and pray one for the other, said the scripture. I'll be St. James, the 5th chapter. And it's been marvelous. Many times I wonder sometimes how that so many things happen. But it's just simple prayer. I'll come up and pray for someone, maybe dying. Sarcomas cancer or something, just eating up. After a while, along the road, you remember me, Brother Branham? I was the one that was so-and-so. Tens of thousands of them whirl around. So, you see, it's just simple faith. It's nothing, anything that we work ourselves up to. It's just something that we believe like a child would believe. Just like you'd promise your little girl a new dress Saturday, the little boy an overhaul jacket. See, they expect that. Just simple, childlike faith. That's all God wants us to be, because we're just children anyhow. And so we are happy to have this time of fellowship with you. May God bless you. So thankful to see this lovely little new church that shows there's a thriving congregation that would undertake to build a church like this. And this little city here and its growing population, I trust that God will expand it so that you'll have to buy the properties next door and build a bigger building. And many hundreds of people being saved. God bless the pastor and the deacons and trustees and all the other associates with us here together. We are not divided. We are one body. We believe that there is one Christ who saved us all. And so that's how we stand. And now, perhaps soon I'll be in the foreign lands again. And now here in America, you can just go out preach, and maybe lay hands on the sick. That's all right. You get by with it, but not when you're on the battlefront. Out there, you face devils. I mean, challenging devils, witch doctors, what they call holy man, and everything. That's not afraid to challenge. But I say this, God being my judge, I've never seen one happen but what God triumphed over with a great victory like that. Every time. We have lit it here, but I didn't think of bringing it. If you've won any or any, just write to us in Indiana, Jeffersonville, Indiana. We'd be glad to send it. And if any time you need a prayer cloth and want to carry it in your Bible, or just write to me, just Jeffersonville, Indiana. We'll send it, no charges on nothing. We do not charge for anything. Everything's free. Jesus said, as freely as you receive, freely give. So we no charges on that. We do have books, but they're not mine. They're books that other men has wrote of the ministry. So we have to buy them, and we get a 40% discount on them. Then we have to haul them to the meetings, and we always place them in the meetings and get somebody to sell them. We give a couple young fellows that goes with us $50 a week to sell the books at the beginning of the meeting. At the end of the meeting, we will not sell them on Sunday. And then we got orders. No matter who it is, if the person comes by and wants a book and hasn't got the money, give it to them anyhow. See? And never turn a person down, because it's not to sell the book. It's always to get the message out. And anyone knows, you brethren, you sell books. There's no money in selling books unless you, nothing, they won't even pay for themselves. Love offerings is what pays for the books. To the people that sometime when I leave on a big campaign, they'll give me a love offering. And when I do that, I take it to my church, turn it into the church, and it goes to foreign missions. Out of that, they give me enough money to live on, $100 a week, for my family and home and automobile and expense and phone calls and things. Of course, that doesn't go for the other phone calls. They run hundreds of dollars a month for phone calls. And I've seen the time that phone calls on long distance alone would average 64 long distance an hour. So you can imagine what it is. It's just not just one little place. It's all the way around the world. And people laying in there waiting for months, hundreds of them on the waiting list now, just for a few minutes, come from Africa, India, Asia, everywhere, to come in on those private interviews. Now, there's where you stand before God and wait until He speaks and tells just what has to be done. And not one time has He ever failed us. So we're thankful for that, grateful to God. I'm going up to Dawson Creek next, and we invite you there. Brother Stoffman came and got me a few moments ago, he and my son, while I was in the room praying for the meeting tonight. And he said he's going to have a breakfast, I believe, on Saturday morning. That's good. And we'll be glad for you to come. Attend the breakfast, attend the meeting, and then pray for me. I want to ask this one favor of you before I turn to the Scriptures. You know, when the winds are blowing hot, and everything's going contrary, and witch doctors on every hand, devil powers challenging on every hand, wonder if I could just depend on you back over here in Grand Prairie sometime each day to whisper a little prayer for me. Will you do that? Will you promise me to do that? Thank you. Thank you. I'll always remember you. Every time coming to you, I'll try to stop and see you,
if coming back and forth. And if I do not see you again until we cross the river, I'll see you on the other side over there. And then remember, the same gospel I teach you about tonight, I'll be standing there with it in my hand, saying it was true. And I'm sure our Lord will vindicate that is true. Not only does He do it then, but He does it now. That He does it now, that is true. I certainly appreciate you and love you with warm Christian love. If any time I can be a favor to you, call me or write me. I'll do anything that lays within my power to help you, make life a little easier for you and the rough places a little smoother. Anytime I can pray for you, do anything for you, let me know. Shall we bow our heads just a moment as we speak to the author of this word? Lord, the God of creation of the heavens and earth, who made all things by Christ our Lord, who sent Him to be the propitiation of our sins, given us His word, which is a water of separation, washed by the water through the word of separation, that through faith, believing it, we are separated from our sins, called out, set apart, ordained to the gospel of the Lord Jesus, the good news. Goes all the way from the pulpit, Lord, to the little housewife that could testify and tell of the goodness of our blessed Savior. We just humbly bow our heads in humiliation, Lord, and thank You to know that we were once alienated from God, without hope, without Christ, without God. And while we were yet sinners, Christ died in our stead to reconcile us back to the great family of God. So we could not be able, Lord, by human speech to ever express the adoration of our hearts for Thy goodness and mercy to us. But Father, in our simple, humble, childlike way, receive our thanksgiving, Lord God. Now I pray, Father, first for Your ministers here at My Brethren. Oh God, I'm so glad to have fellowship with them. It said once in the Bible that how sweet it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It's like the anointing oil that was on Aaron's beard that run to the hems of his skirt. How we thank You for that, Lord, for brethren of like precious faith that believes on God. We thank You for their churches, and I pray, God, that You'll bless their efforts wherever they are, and may the congregations grow and the grace of God be with them, Lord. May signs and wonders accompany their ministry, Lord, that'll shake this nation with the power of God. Grant it, Lord. Send us man out of this wilderness like John the Baptist, who came forth burly and blasting that prophet, speaking of a Messiah was coming with his fan in his hand that would thoroughly purge his floors and burn the chaff with unquenchable fire. Now, Father God, bless this audience tonight. Here sets mothers with their little babies. See dads and mothers sitting together and sick people and needy. I pray, God, that the angel of mercy will sweep over here tonight. May there not be a feeble person in our midst when this service is closed. May we go to our homes tonight rejoicing, saying, did not our hearts burn within us as He talked to us along the way? Grant it, Lord, for we know You remain the same yesterday, today, and forever. Bless this people, Father, and if it happens to come to pass that some of us crosses over the river before we see each other again, God grant that we'll all meet again somewhere under the great beyond, and there we will fellowship together forever. How I would like to go home with each one of these men and women, visit their homes. Be a blessing to me, Lord, to sit down and read a scripture, kneel down at their table and pray. How gracious it would be. But Father, the day is way spent. The sun is going down. Eternity is coming in. Oh, we must battle as long as we can. God, if I never get to do it in this world, may I be able to do it in the world that is to come. Give us of Thy grace. May the Holy Spirit speak to us tonight through the written word. Close our mouths to anything that would be wrong, and open our hearts wide to receive it. May the seed fall in good ground that'll bring forth a hundredfold for the glory of God. We ask it in the name of His beloved child, Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. I wish to refer to just a scripture tonight, and I was so sorry I kept you late last evening. I was talking and I just talked too much. So thank you, sir. That's awful nice. A lot of grace, brother. I thank you for that. That's very nice. Makes me feel good. Know that you put an effort forth and it's appreciated. You know what I mean. Now, what's my cause here? To try to help you. Try to make life a little smoother for you. And what good would it do me to come here as an imposter or a hypocrite? I'm not paid to come. I do not ask money. It's not popularity. I shun that. See? So, A man who tries to be popular cannot be right with God. So it's not that. It's because in my heart I love you. I'm tired and wore out. I'm fixing to go for a little rest for a week or two before I enter the services again. But my love was that I just couldn't pass you by without stopping in, saying, how are you, and having a little meeting and associating with you a little while. So remember, what I'm telling you is this, that your Lord and my Lord is not dead. He's risen from the dead, and He's with us. We are His children. Now, in healing, if you'll just appropriate the faith and say, now, if He's here, then His attitude towards one is His attitude towards all. Now, maybe someone will have just a little high faith that can reach even above yours and touch him and bring down a vision over him. That doesn't mean that that person's the only one can be healed. No, you have God's attitude just the same to you, but you just can't stand it. It just tears you to pieces. How many understands that? Just raise up your hand. Jesus said, pardon me, Jesus said, when one woman touched His garment, He said, I perceive that I have gotten weak, virtue's gone from me. So you can realize, listen, my brother, sister, maybe our last time meeting, no one, there's no one in this world to ever know what I've went through. That's right. You can't explain it. You can't explain God. And you sit in a meeting, not in here, but many times you talk a few minutes to find, here's critics over here, here's a doubter, here's one superstitious, here's one a devil-possessed sitting there, and all that, you feel that coming against you like a breath. And then you've got to see, there's a godly saint sitting there trying to find God. Here's another one who's wondering and doubting. Here's a little baby dying. Here's one who's cross-eyed. Here's a daddy sitting here with cancer. God, and then all that, by the thousands meeting you at one time, you don't realize how it tears you to pieces, see? And there, and just think, Satan's waiting for one little crooked word somewhere. That's all, see? And knowing that you're human, you have to completely rely upon Jesus Christ. Just completely throw your life to Him. Now, in the Scriptures of St. Matthew, the 14th chapter and the 27th verse, we read this. But straightway Jesus spake unto them, saying, be of a good cheer. It is I. Be not afraid. I wish to take that for a text. It is I. It is I. Three words. And now I want us tonight, so we can hurry, to attend a testimony meeting. You like testimonies? We all do. And would you not like to have lived in the days of the apostles and sit down somewhere on a log out by the lakeside and heard those apostles testify? How many would like to have heard that? Just heard them together, those who walk with Jesus. And surely, if they walked with Him and knew Him, they would know how to testify about Him. Don't you believe that? Sure, they would know how His life. They know just what He was. And remember, they were not angels now. They were man. They had their ups and downs just like we do. Many times people think when a ministry becomes supernatural, they think that person ought to wear robe, clothes, and touch me not. And, you know, when a person acts like that, they're trying to be something that they're not. God uses man, just ordinary man. When you see a person like that, to me, it's a stuffed shirt, see? Somebody trying to be something they're not. Holier than thou art, not touch me. God can't use that, you know that. So I'll say this one thing. Some of the finest old hearts that I ever shook a hand under, beat under an old blue patch shirt. That's right. Real pair of steel gray eyes, look in the face and say, preacher, I believe it. Brother, you can depend on that. Mark it down. Callus from plow handles or something. That's right. You don't have to have on a tuxedo coat and your collar turned around to be a Christ-fearing Christian. No. It's not what you wear. It's what you are inside, what makes you. Not how smart you are, but how much you are on the inside. To us, there's none of us any good. If there's any goodness about us, there's only one good, and that's God, Christ said. But I'd like to go to a testimony meeting and just sit down and get me a seat and hear the apostles testify. Oh, I've always thought I'd love to do that. And I always thought I'd like to hear Jesus when he said, stretch forth his loving arms and said, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Oh, you know, they got so they claim if a voice has ever spoke, you know it more than I do. A voice, it never dies. It lives on like radium. It goes on and on and on like a pebble dropping in the water. The little waves carry on and on for miles. Vibrations till you cannot see them with your natural eye, but they're carrying on and on and on. And your air, when you speak, that's where you get on electronics and the radio, that airwave, it goes on, it never dies. I'd like to live till science maybe could pick up that voice of his. They claim that someday, if they keep going on, they'll be able to do it. Pick up his that literal voice when he said, come unto me, all ye labor and heavy laden. I'll give you rest. Well, I may not live to that day. Frankly, I don't think the world will stand that long. We're so close to the end time. But I would like to be with you to preach to you a while on those things, but I've tried to make our little messages just simple and drama, cause them tired, and then you'd understand it better. But I may not live to hear that, but there's one thing I do want to hear, and I believe I'll hear it. It was well done, my good and faithful servant. Enter into the joys of the Lord. That's what I'm expecting to hear someday. I'm sure he won't disappoint me. And if he does turn me down at the end of the road, I'll still love him. If he sends me to hell and I can still love in hell, I'll love him anyhow, see, because I deserve to be turned down at the beginning. See, and if I had 10,000 lives to live and there's nothing at the end of them, if there's no God, no Christ, I'd still take this Christian way to live anyhow. To have men and women that I can associate with, it makes life so much different. See, if you just be a Christian. Now let's break in upon this testimony meeting and listen to the apostles testify. It must have been about sundown, about this time in the evening, when the big brawny back fishermen begin to push the boat off of the shore. Now I can just see him as he takes a little ship and his big brawny back pushing, shoving the boat, and as it gets off the shore, gets it off into the water, into the blue Galilee, and then he climbs up over the seats and takes his position by the side of his brother Andrew, and the little oars begin to dip into the water, and they'd make a dip and then wave bye-bye to those on the shore. Because it had a great meeting that afternoon, and they were leaving, and the people loved them. There's something about the love of God in our hearts that it just kills us to part from one another. A real Christian group, when they come together, when they have to leave one another in church, I've seen them just stand and hug one another and cry, see. I think of Paul kneeling down on the shore and praying, say, I know you won't see my face no more. And how it is to separate from one another. We used to sing a song down in the old Baptist church in the South, blessed be the tie that binds our hearts in Christian love. The fellowship of kindred minds is like to that above. When we asunder part, it gives us inward pain, but we shall still be joined in heart and hope to meet again. There must have been that feeling as the little ship moved out into the waters and that waving goodbye and all, saying, come back, be with us again, brethren. Seeing the man on the bank and them wiping the tears from their eyes and waving to them, come back and be with us again. As the little ship moved on out into the waters, and after a while they come out of sight, they couldn't see no more. The dark was settling down, and they had been pulling. In those days, they pulled by oar, a two-man in one seat. And they take these oars and keep time as they pull the little boats. And then if the wind was blowing, they hoist a little sail and help them along. And they were crossing over the Galilee. And after it got for a little rest period, we believe, that it must have been young John. He was the youngest among them and rather an enthusiastic little apostle. And so when they pulled their oars out of the water, and someone must have said, brethren, let us take a little break and rest for a few minutes. And let's have a little testimony meeting. And that's the one we want to break in on. Young John must have said, well, today has been the day that settled it forever for me. I have been a believer since I was a baby. I can remember my precious old mother reading the Bible stories to me and how she told me that when our people come across out of the lands of Egypt, was brought up into this country that we inherited by God. She used to tell me stories of how great Jehovah was and how He cared for His people. And how I used to lay and look up into her pretty face. And she'd say to me, John, all beyond the stars yonder there's a great God that loves His people. Don't forget it, my son. And then she told me that when God Jehovah had called His children up out of Egypt, that He provides for those who take a step to walk in His commandments. And they were following Jehovah out of Egypt. And they got out into the desert, and they run out of bread. They didn't have no bread to eat. And Jehovah brought bread down out of the skies and laid it on the ground. And the next morning, the only thing they had to do is go pick it up and eat the bread. And I used to say to my mommy, you might have said, Mommy, perhaps God's got a great bunch of ovens up there in heaven. And a whole lot of angels would work overtime. And they would bake all this bread. And then the angels would get big baskets and run down and lay it all around the camp. She said, No, son. You're too young to understand. But you see, son, Jehovah is a creator. He just created that bread. He don't have to have ovens to bake it. He just created that bread. And it fell upon the ground. No, John might have said, that always stayed with my heart, how the good Jehovah could create bread and send it down on the earth, already cooked. Brethren, I want to make my confession and this testimony tonight here on this boat that I know that we're not following some false prophet. We're not following some imposter. For when I saw him today take those little loaves, 5 loaves and 2 little fishes, and break that bread and feed 5,000 people, I know that was God. That settled it for me because He did the works of God. Do you remember, brethren, He said once before to us, if I do not the works of my Father, then believe me not. But what did He do, brethren? I want to ask this congregation, What kind of an Adam did He turn loose? Took those little biscuits and broke 5 of those and fed 5,000 people. Not growed wheat and He does it all to... Sure, but He bypassed all the routines of nature. Not only did He grow wheat there, He growed bread, not only bread, but baked bread. Already seasoned and ready to eat. That's our God. Fishes. Why, He put every fish in the water. But He took these fishes and broke them. Not just raised up another fish out of the water, but broke a fish and went back and took another piece, growed on while He was breaking that one, a fried fish. Already seasoned, rolled in cornmeal and fried. Ready to eat. How did He do it? What kind of an Adam would the science say today that He turned loose there? Now I can hear John say, brethren, it was so astounding to me. I climbed up behind the rock and looked and seen where He was. I could find where He was getting it from. But He just took the bread and held it out and broke a piece and laid it on Andrew's basket and reached back, and there was another piece ready when He reached His hand for it. So that proves it to me that He's God. He's Jehovah. Only Jehovah of the Old Testament could create bread and here to feed hungry people. And here that Jehovah is manifested. And I know that that is the Son of God. Could only be. He's associated with God somewhere because He done the same things God did. It must have been Simon Peter about that time said, "That's a good testimony, John. May I give my testimony now? You know, brethren, that I was a fisherman. My father before me was a fisherman. My father was a godly old Pharisee. And you remember he stayed in the church a great deal of the time. And we fished on the river here on the lake. And my mother, and how I would see her and Dad take Andrew and I the morning when we went to get the fish and kneel down around the side of the table. And how I'd see Dad look up and say, Jehovah, I need fish today for the market to feed my little children. Will you help me catch a good catch today? And how that when we'd catch the fish and come into the shore, how that Andrew and I and Dad would kneel down by the side of the boat and thank God for the fishes before we took them to the market. Oh, we need more fathers and mothers like that. Bring up a child in the way that should go. One day I remember he might have said this way that we'd had a great catch that day, oh, a tremendous catch. And we pulled our little boat into the shore and I jumped ashore and tied up the boat and was helping the fish out into the baskets. And after we had prayed, I can see my dad brush back the gray hairs from his face, put his arm around me and set me up on the boat. Said, Simon, my little boy, I've raised you to serve God the best of my knowledge. And he said, Simon, I, like all true believers, have looked forward for the day that when the Messiah would come. I thought I would see Him in my day. But Simon, I'm getting old now, and my days are numbered. My steps are getting shorter. I perhaps won't see Him. But Simon, my son, you are the younger, so perhaps you will see the Messiah that we've looked for all these years, the hope of Israel. Simon, before He comes, there will be many things as raised up down through the age and saying they are Messiahs and all these things. And when by the time He is coming, there will be all kinds of things raised up. But Simon, the churches have got off on many tantrums. But I want to tell you, my son, you remember to believe what Moses said, our prophets, that when this Messiah comes, Moses told us that the Lord our God should raise up a prophet likened unto Moses. And he would be the one that we were to go to. And Simon, whatever you do, always remember, no matter how anything looks, remember the Messiah will be a prophet, for it's according to the Scriptures. Don't be carried away, Simon, with foolish things and strange doctrines, but stay with the Scripture, my son, because Moses, our leader, that we know God sent Moses, and Moses said the Messiah will be a prophet. And the sign of the Messiah now, we haven't had a prophet for hundreds of years. But one day, there will be one raised on the scene that'll be a prophet, and that'll be the Messiah. Because we're waiting for that day. And he might have said, and brethren, put his arms around Andrew and said, Andrew, you remember when you went to hear John preach speaking of a Messiah? Well, I thought it was one of these eras that they all had. There's this and that. And I never paid much attention to you, Andrew. But One day when you finally persuaded me to go see this fellow that was been introduced as a Messiah. And when I went to see him, brethren, when I walked up into the face of this man and Andrew going up along the hill said, "That's him. You see the one? Why, he don't look no different than any other man," I said to Andrew. But he said, "Just a minute. Let's move through the crowds. He's fixing to speak just in a moment, and everybody will be breathless while he's speaking." And we moved through the crowd, and Andrew had been seen John introduce him. And so then I moved up close, and I thought, I'm going to see, get a good look at him, and I'm going to hear what he says, see if he's with the Scriptures. So I moved up close that day when he got ready to speak. And I thought, now I'll just see what Andrew's been talking about. And when before he opened his mouth to say anything, his eyes fastened up on me. And he looked at me and said, "Your name is Simon, and you are the son of Jonas." Oh, brethren, that fixed it for me. Not only did he know who I was, he knew that godly old daddy of mine that had warned me and told me what the Messiah would be. Therefore, I know that that was God's prophet, the Messiah, that was raised up. That finished the testimony for me. Must have been Philip about that time that raised up and said, "Now, Brother Nathaniel, I'm going to tell this on us now in the testimony meeting here out on the ocean." Wouldn't you love to have been standing listening at him? Sitting up on the rail of the boat listening at them? And Philip might have said, "Well, I was standing there, Simon, when I saw him do that or heard him. And I seen the expression on your face. You just fell right at his feet. And I thought surely that big burly man, Simon, would just droop his shoulders down. And he told you your name would be a little stone after this. And I know that would be a good fitting name for you because you were solid when you believed anything, you believed it." And then I thought, how would he ever know that? So I'd read the Scriptures too. So I knew my good friend sitting up here at the end of the boat, which is Nathaniel. So I took around the mountain to find him. And I found him under a tree praying. And when he finished his prayer and had gotten up, I said, "Come see who we have found. Jesus, the son of Joseph, that's the Messiah." Oh, now he said, "Could there be anything good come out of Nazareth?" And I told him, "Come see." Remember along the road our conversation. And as soon as I brought Nathaniel into the presence of our Lord, he said, "Behold an Israelite in whom there is no guile." And I tell you, I'm going to stop my testimony now. "Now, Nathaniel, you finish it." "Well," said Nathaniel, all the doubt was taken out of me. But I was astonished as soon as I seen the man, the first time I'd ever seen him, did he tell me that I was an Israelite and no guile. How would the man ever know me when I never laid eyes on him in my life until I come to his meeting? And I thought I would question, and I was so enthused to think, could the news be true, or was I just dreaming a dream? So I said, "Rabbi," or "Reverend," "teacher," whatever you wish to call it, "when did you ever know me?" "Why, you have never seen me in your life. And how would you know that I was an honest, just man, no guile?" He said, "Why, before Philip called you, I saw you when you were under the tree." Brethren, I know then that was the prophet that we've been looking for all these years. And I confessed him publicly before my priest and all the rest of them, knowing that I'd be excommunicated from the church for saying such a thing or taking a stand. But it made no difference to me. I know the Scripture said that's the kind of a man it would be. So I stayed with what the Scripture said, because Moses, we were taught to believe Moses and the prophets, and they said that this Messiah would be a prophet, and we haven't seen anything of it for hundreds of years. And here it was right with us, and I know the man did not know me. So it settled it for me. And about that time, Andrew must have raised up and said, "Brethren, I would like to say another thing. Do you remember the day that he said he was going down to Jericho?" "Yes." "And he had need go by Samaria, and we all wondered, why is he going up around Samaria instead of going down to Jericho? But he had need to go by the Samaritans, and you know we didn't have any dealing with them at all. But he stopped, and we thought maybe he didn't want to show his face in Samaria. So he sat at the well, and he sent us in to get some food. And when we come back, do you remember what we seen? We were embarrassed. Our Lord was talking to a woman of ill fame. A beautiful young woman, but she was a bad woman. She's standing out there with the marking of a bad woman coming to the well at that time of day, and he was talking to her. Do you remember what he said? He said, we hid behind the bush to listen to see what he is saying, see what our Lord would say to this ill-famed woman. And said, he said, woman, bring me a drink. She said, it's not customary for you Jews to ask us Samaritans such things. We have no dealings with each other. He said, but if you knew who you were talking to, you'd ask me for a drink. And she said, you have nothing to draw with. And our Lord said, go get your husband and come here. She said, I do not have a husband. Do you remember, brethren, how we felt? Uh-oh. Now, he slipped up. He's made a mistake. I do not have a husband. Then we heard his words. Thou hast said well, for you've had five husbands, and the one you live with now is not your husband. And then do you remember that Samaritan woman of the city of Sychar there, what she said? Sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. Now we Samaritans know that there is coming the Anointed One called the Christ, the Messiah. And when we know what his sign will be, that will be his sign. He'll be a prophet. When he comes, he'll show us these things. But who art thou? You must be one of his servants. He said, I'm he. Oh, how have we seen the expression on that woman's face when she set down her water bucket and ran into the city and began to scream, come see a man that's told me all the things of my life. Now, he never told her all the things. She was just so happy he just told her the one thing. But if he knew that one thing, he knew all things. Amen. Come see a man who's told me the things that's in my life. Isn't this the very sign of the Messiah? And he's shouting right out there on the well. And they brought the man out. And the Bible says that the whole city believed on Jesus because that he told that woman that thing. Must have been Matthew the scribe taking down this testimony so I could read it to you tonight. See? He said, could I speak next, brethren? Oh, yes, Matthew. Go ahead and speak. Do you remember the morning that we were going into Jericho? And Rebecca, our sister down there in Jericho, she was the wife of Zacchaeus. And he was a businessman, a tax collector in the city. And he was a rich man. And you know, Rebecca believed on our Lord. And she had prayed and she had prayed for her husband to become a Christian. But of course, he was one of the big payers in the church, and he played golf with the priest, you know, understand what I mean. He had his social affairs, and they all went out together, and they had their big times together. So it was hard for him to pull away from his membership. And therefore, you know, anybody that follows our Lord is excommunicated from the churches right now. See, they have nothing to do with them. And so, we was asked by our sister Rebecca to pray for Zacchaeus, her husband, that he would receive our Lord. And you remember when we stood on the corner and told Zacchaeus, Zacchaeus, you are a Bible reader. What seekest thou? What sayest thou of Messiah? Rebekah's testimony is true. He is the prophet that the Lord our God was going to raise up in these days. Oh, but Rabbi Levinsky tells me that he's a false prophet. He's a Beelzebub. He's possessed with a fortune-telling spirit. I won't believe it. Walks away. And you remember Rebekah's testimony that day, how she said when Zacchaeus got up early that morning and she'd prayed all night long that Zacchaeus would get to see Jesus when he came into the city. Now, women, that's the way to get your husband one to God. It takes some praying, holding on. All night she prayed. And the next morning, she knew that Jesus was going to visit the city that day. So she all night she had prayed that Zacchaeus would see some kind of a miracle that Jesus would perform that would change her husband's heart. And you know, we're taught this, friends, the prayer of faith will do great things. All things are possible to them that believe. And then Matthew might have said, and brethren, you remember that morning when we met Rebekah? She said, I prayed all night. And this morning about daylight, well, Zacchaeus got up early, put on his best robe and groomed his beard, you know, because he was an important man. So put on his best clothes, you know. And I said, where are you going, darling? Oh, just for a morning stroll. That was unusual, you know, because he didn't get up that early. So Rebecca got down on the floor and said, thank you, Lord. I know you're dealing with him, see, because he's been so grouchy the last few days. See? That's usually when he's on the road. See? Oh, he's cut me off to everything. But I know that you'll lead him somehow right around to where Jesus is. Well, now, you remember we took a... And she stayed home to pray. So you remember what Zacchaeus told us after the story? He said all down in his heart all night long he had dreamed of seeing God dealing with him. And the next morning when he got up, he went out and went down to the corner of the gate of the south side of the city to which he was to appear. And when he got there, but daylight, the Galileans had piled all over the gates to wait for him. Well, he was a little man, so he was small in stature, and he said, I'm too little to ever get in a bunch like that. I never see him. But I'm going to give him a piece of my mind when I see him. I'll tell him he's a false prophet. He's no seer. So he happened to think, you know, if he comes in here, I won't see him, but I know he's going over to Levinsky's over there for dinner, my competitor, so I'll tell you what, I'll go up here, and I know he'll pass by Hallelujah Avenue, where it goes down Glory Street, and he usually passes that way, you know. So I'll go up there and stand up there, and when he passes by, I'll see him. Well, got up there, and he's groomed all up, so I'll stand right here, and when he comes up, I'm going to say, Rabbi, I'll slap my wife out of the bed of any night because of you. I want you to leave her alone. I want her back in church with the ladies sewing circles and all that. I mean, why, I'm a disgraced businessman in this city because she's been hanging after a bunch of fanatics, a bunch of holy, you know, people like you. See, so I want you to get out of the country. I'll tell him, boy, and everybody know I'm some fella. I got some brains. See, and you stand on the corner and think, well, you know what? That crowd of following. That's right. They will. Wherever he goes, they'll go too. You know what? I'm so little, when they get up here, they just might trample over the top of me. So he's only, I don't know how to do it. So he looked and there was a sycamore tree standing there. Thought, well, you know what? I believe I'll get up in that. And when I get up there, now what am I doing all this for? But if I get up there, I'll see him when he comes by. And I'll preach him a sermon from the top of this tree. So he looked around, and he was too short to reach the limb, you know. But he was determined he is going to see him. If you're determined, God will fix a way for you to see him. All right? You just be determined, see. And so he looked around, and he had to think, well, what is... Well, the garbage collector hadn't come by yet this morning. and the garbage pail was sitting over there. So he goes over to get the garbage pail. It's too heavy. Well, nothing else around, but I want to see him. Oh, you'll do strange things if you want to see him. You do things you don't think you'll do. Embarrassing things. So he puts his arm around the garbage pail. Here he comes now. And just about that time, here come two or three businessmen around the corner, his competitors. Then he's caught in a trap. Maybe some of you in the same shape tonight. You're caught amongst this holy roller. So there you are. Might as well just take it. So there they was. He had the pail in his arms. His little face got red. But he didn't care. He's going to see him anyhow. That's the way. Now, Zacchaeus, now you're getting right. Takes it over and sets it down with the tree and shinnies up the... I don't mean to say that. We call it America, shinny up the tree. You know, it's get up on the tree and climb up it. You got up there, got him, sat down where two limbs come together like this. Sat down across those limbs. That's a good place to sit down a while, where two ways meets, yours and God's. Think it over a little bit. You're going to die one of these days. You've got to meet the God who wrote this word. You've got to give it an answer one of these days. So I hope that as many Zacchaeus as you're tonight will sit on that cross place tonight. Make up your mind. What a pitiful looking sight he was, sitting up there picking the splinters out of him, garbage all over his new suit. But he was determined to see Jesus. He wanted to see him. So he began to think, you know, what's making me do this? You know, Rebecca told me that that guy was a prophet. And he could see. Now, I don't believe that. There's no such a thing in this day. My priest told me there's no prophets of this day. Prophets was hundreds of years ago, way back in Moses' time. But there's no prophets today. So, you know what I believe? Before I give him a piece of my mind, I believe I'll just cover myself up so he can't see me. So he got all the limbs and pulled them all around him and camouflaged himself so nobody could see him. So he left him one big leaf like this, like a door. He could raise it down and look out. And he sat there wondering. Now, he'll never know I'm up here because he can't see me up in this tree. And I'll just see how much prophet he is. And every once in a while he hears some noise. You know, usually where Jesus is, he's a lot of noise. I don't know why, but it's usually that way. And so he pulled the leaf down, looked out over the leaf, nobody coming. After a while, he heard a noise. He looked down, and the streets was beginning to crowd full of people. He peeped under the leaf, you know, watching, looking around to see. After a while, a great, big, strong man come around the corner of the street, standing full. I'm very sorry this morning, friends. Would you step back and give our master room? He's very weary and tired. He's been up much through the night. He's been healing the sick yesterday, and things has been done. Would you please step back? That must be who Rebecca said was Simon Peter. He looks like a big, brawny-looking fella. Would you stand? Here comes some more man behind. We are very sorry, but give our master a room, will you? Because he's very tired this morning. Well, I thought, now he'll never see me sitting here. And so after a while, I looked over on the corner, and there stood a friend of mine with a sick baby that I'd just been down there and talked to him, and the doctor that eats at my same restaurant as I and the priest eats at, told that man that baby would die at any time, and its fever was so high, and here they are wrapped up in a blanket standing out there to see this fanatic come around. After a while, the little father run out in front of him and fell down and said, "Would you have mercy on my baby?" And he just touched the blanket. The little girl got to jumping and running, going away. And when he looked down, there was something about this man, Jesus, that when he saw him, he changed his mind. He didn't feel like giving him a balling out. If you ever look straight into the Scriptures and see Jesus, what he is, you won't criticize him no more. He didn't want to ball him out. But he pulled a little leaf down and began to watch him. Come on. He had his head down, walking, study. The Bible said there's no beauty we should desire him. So he probably a little stoop-shouldered fellow walking along the street. And when he got right under where he was at, he stopped. And here he was, looking over this leaf. He looked up, said, "Zacchaeus, come down. I'm going home with you for dinner today. Not only knew he was in the tree, but knew who he was. Zacchaeus, come down, make haste, come down, run away. Rebecca's waiting for us. You remember how? Oh, yes. All of us said, remember that. Yes, sir. We remember that testimony. What Zacchaeus said up there that day at dinner, how he was ashamed, and he said, Lord, if I've done anything wrong, I'll make it right. I know that thou art the Messiah. Sure, I'm satisfied. When you call my name, he's sitting up there in that tree. Oh, yes. And say, when we went out of the gate, you remember that old blind Bartimaeus is out there on the other side there? You remember his testimony, brethren? Yes, I remember it. He was sitting there dreaming of the days that when he could see, when he used to be able to run around and pick little flowers along on the Judean hill.
But he don't clown for the devil.
He said, I do nothing till the Father, what I see the Father doing, that doeth the Son likewise. How many know that scripture? St. John, the 5th chapter, when Jesus passed through the pool of Bethesda and healed one man, left the multitude, thousands laying there, lame, blind, halt, withered. He went to a man that maybe had a prostate trouble. Maybe he had TB. It was retarded. He had 38 years. Why didn't he heal those that was crippled and blind? I asked right among every one of them, went over to this fellow. I remember the Bible said Jesus knew that he had been in this condition. And he said, will thou be made well? Said, I have no one to put me in the water. Said, take up your bed. Said, somebody can beat me. He can walk. Said, somebody outruns him. He gets down there first. Get in the water when the angel troubled the water. Said, take up your bed and go into your house. And he was questioned. If he did that in this city tonight, he'd be questioned. What's the devil say? We got a man selling pencils down here on the streets blind. Let these divine healers heal him. See that devil? The same ones that, if thou be the Son of God, perform a miracle before me. Turn this bread in, this rocks into bread. I'll believe you. The same devil, when they had him in the courts, put a rag around his head, a bunch of drunken soldiers, hit him on the head with a stick, said, if you're a prophet, tell us who hit you. We'll believe you. God don't clown! Jesus said, verily, verily, I say unto you, the Son can do nothing in himself, but what he sees the Father doing, that doeth the Son likewise. There you are. There's the real servant of God. I can do nothing in myself, but what I see, not hear, see. Then Jesus never done one thing until God showed him by a vision what to do, or he told something wrong in St. John 5:19. Verily, verily, that's absolutely, absolutely. I say unto you, the Son can do nothing in himself. That was the Son, the body that God dwelt in. The Son can do nothing in himself. But what I see the Father doing. That doeth the Son likewise. The Father worketh, and I worketh the other two. In other words, Father shows me what to do, and I just act it out as a drama. Now, blind Bartimaeus said there, said, who's passing by? Oh, they said, shut up. Shoved him over. And there, finally, a kind little woman, a servant of Christ. All servants of Christ are kind. You believe that? Amen. They like to show courtesy to those who are needy. Help the blind across the street. Bring them to the meeting. Do things kind. When the neighbor's sick, go help them. Never expect money. Do good to others. All Christ's servants are like that. They like to help those who are run down and tramped over. This poor old blind man pushed over there, and all of them hollering once, saying, hail, hail, there's the king, the prophet, the Galilean prophet, hail to him. The others saying, away with that imposter. Others say, come raise the dead, you hypocrite. Plenty of them laying up here on the hill. Come up here and raise one of our men. We had a godly priest that died last week. Come raise him. If you're the Son of God, Jesus never opened his mouth. Just kept walking on. All the is going to Calvary right then, going up to Jerusalem. The burden of the world was upon him. Every man that ever died, every sin that was ever committed was laid upon him. And he knew he was going to death. I can hear Bartimaeus say, who passes by? Nobody would tell him. Directly this kind little woman said, sir, let me help you up, kind sir. Oh, you're a nice lady. Who are you? She told, I am the servant of the Christ. The what? The Christ. You are a Jew? Yes. Have you not read in the scriptures where the Messiah was coming? Oh, the son of David? Yes. What kind of a man will he be? Oh, he'll be a prophet, said blind Bartimaeus. He'll be a prophet. That's him that just passed by. Oh, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. Someone said, shut up. How could he hear that? Go to Jericho one time and see where he was sitting and where Jesus is at. About 300 yards. Thousands of people saying, hail to the prophet. Others said, away with the hypocrite. Overripe food thrown at him and everything like that. Out of our town. See? And others blessing him and some cursing him. Same thing today. Same thing. Some say, it's true, it's of God. Others say, it's a devil. There you are. See? God takes his man, but never his spirit. The devil takes his man, but never the spirit. This girl lives on somebody else. Just keeps coming back, like the Holy Spirit. Now, they both live today. They both live in Grand Prairie. You know. Sure they are. Both spirits. That wherever men are gathered together, you find both spirits. Here they was. And now, there, Jesus could not have heard him, literally. It's too much noise. But blind Bartimaeus must have said this. I know then that that's that Messiah that I know would come. And I know that he's a prophet, so he must have fell on his knees and said, Jehovah, Jehovah. See the comparison to the rest of the Scripture. The woman had touched his garment. He's a high priest tonight. Amen. That you can touch his garment. Amen. Jehovah, I'm blind. I have no money for an operation, and they couldn't do me no good anyhow. Jehovah, that's the son of David, and he's passing me by. Have mercy. His faith stopped him. The faith of a blind beggar, an insignificant person. Not his cry. He couldn't have heard it. Too much. One saying this and the other saying something else. But his faith stopped him because Jesus said so. Amen. And remember, with the sins of the world on him, going to Jerusalem, the faith of one beggar stopped him in his tracks. Amen. Wish I had a few days of life to preach to you one night just on preaching. And Jesus stood still. And the sun stood still. One of these days, time will stand still. But Jesus stood still. Said, thy faith has saved thee. You remember what blind Bartimaeus said? He said, if that was the Son of God, that man was a prophet, my faith was strong enough to stop him. And I asked him for my sight, and he said, thy faith has saved thee. I stood looking. The crowds went on down the road. I said, it has to be so. It has to be so. I know it's so. And after a while, I began to see a shadow. I began to notice, and there was my hands. I run down the road rejoicing. Oh, sure. Oh, what a testimony meeting they were having. No doubt they were weeping and shouting and jumping up and down in the boat. Our glory to God, praise God, brother. We know we are right. We know that he is the Messiah. Amen. So is it today. You take all your dead theology you want to, I'll take the living Christ. Amen. For me and my house, we'll serve God. For oh, I like an experience. A year of thunder. A word of God made flesh and dwelt among us. Amen. That's me. That testimony meeting. About that time, the beginning of us, the devil must have looked up across the Galilean hill and said, oh, there they are. Out there having a testimony meeting, but they've gone off without him. He's not with them now. So if he's not with them now, now's my time to get him. My precious brothers. That's what he could say again. The churches are going off without him. They're going off on a great denominational spree. Yes. Our Pentecostal brethren are trying to get more members in this one or more members in that one. Having great programs going on. Great things trying to compare with the other churches. We're not to do that. Let's stay with Jesus.
The
devil says, now I'll sink them. I've got him gone off of that, and that's just what he's trying to do now. So he began to blow his poison breath. The sea went into a nervous prostration. Here the waves begin to jump and to flip and to, said, I'll sink them now! Standing glittering eyes on every wave and the lightning a flashing, the thunders a roaring. Said, we'll get them now! Because we got them out here without him. That's what the devil's done to the church today. Gone off without Jesus on a great big denominational spree. And the first thing you know, other kind of things of the world and trying to compare with the world. We can't compare with the world. Don't go over on the world's ground to get the people in. We've got something they haven't got. Hallelujah. We got Jesus. They got glamour. How can we compare with them with glamour? The gospel is not a glare. It's a glow. Sure. And you can't glow it. It gets in you and glows itself. Amen. Yes. It's what we're trying to do. Get on some kind of a tantrum to get more than the Baptists or more than the Methodists. And how make our churches look like theirs and our denomination equal theirs. And all nonsense.
Amen.
Let's go back to Christ.
Amen.
Let's get back to the old-fashioned prayer meeting. Back to the godly nights and tears and crying before God until we see the living God moving among us. Prayer meetings breaking out and people coming under conviction. Back to that. He's caught us off on a tantrum too. Now, what happened? All hopes is gone. The oars broke. The sail went out. But you know, I don't want to leave you sitting out there. We don't want to stay there. But you know, it's just like Jesus. The Frenchman calls him Jesus. It's just like Jesus. He won't leave you. You know what he done? He knew this was going to get in trouble. He knew this something's going to happen out there. And he knew something's going to happen to us. He's God. He knew the end from the beginning. You know what he done? He climbed the highest hill there was in Palestine. Farther up you go, the farther you can see. So he climbed up the top of the highest hill so he could watch them. When they got in trouble and needed him, he could be a very present help in a time of trouble. And brother, when they crucified him at Calvary, the world thought they had him. Death thought they had him. Hell thought it had him. The devil thought he had him. But he broke every seal, not only climbed through Calvary, but beyond every moon and star.
Amen.
He sits at the right hand of the majesty tonight.
Amen.
And his eyes on the sparrow. And I know he watches me, don't you? He sees our trouble, our frustrations. Everything whirling this way, and some of them kind of say, well, I just don't believe it, and they send this way. Sickness, cancer, diseases, all kinds of things setting amongst Christians, getting off acting worldly and everything. Just let the whip come in, that's all. But remember, he's setting up high, watching you, seeing what you're going to do. Right in the darkest of the hour, when all hope is gone for a revival, here he comes walking on the sea. Here he comes walking down along on the sea. You know what? Those disciples are just about like a lot of people today. That was the only help they could ever get. The only thing that could help them. And they were afraid of it. They said he looks like a spook. He must be a fortune teller. It must be a telepathy. They were afraid of it. That's what it is today. People don't know what to do about it. He's walking right among us again.
Amen.
Walking among us in the trouble. When atomic bombs and everything's hanging everywhere. But right in this dark hour when the churches is all confused and tore apart and denominational differences, Jesus comes walking around among us. And the people say, I don't know. I don't know. Now, it didn't come to our organization. We had to watch, you see. But what was the words? It is I. Be not afraid. So tonight, Grand Prairie, I'm your brother. He is your Lord. But that's Him moving among you. You Pentecostal people. Does not the Bible say, did not Paul say, if you all speak with tongues, and there come in one among you who is unlearned, there's no interpretation to it, will he not say you're mad? But if one is a prophet and reveal the secret of the heart, then they'll all fall down. Say, truly, God is among you. I'm not an outcast. I'm your brother. If Jesus could speak with an audible voice tonight, you'd hear him say the same thing. Don't be afraid. It is I. He's not afraid. It's the same God, same Spirit. A little while the world won't see me no more, yet you'll see me, the believer, for I'll be with you, even in you, to the end of the world. The works that I do shall you also. He prophesied in this last days in the evening time, that same thing would take place, that we've been through it this week, as it was in the days of Sodom. That's what was? Not Noah now. I remember he explained that, but Sodom. This is the time of Sodom, when the world's going to be burned, not drowned, burned. It's going to be burned. And this sign was to return, not an ark, but a God dwelling in the flesh of His people. In His church.
Jesus said, at that day you'll know it, I'm in the Father, the Father in me, and I in you, and you in me. It's God in you. All that God was, He poured into Christ, and all Christ was, He poured into the church. So it's God above us, God with us, and God in us. No wonder we were commissioned to baptize using Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Not three different gods, three offices of one God. See? God above us, and the Father, God in or with us, in the Son, cleansing His way, condensing, coming down, making a way that He could get back and bring His people back to make manifested sons of God. Like they had Him in the Garden of Eden, the whole world's been groaning and waiting for that hour for the manifestation of the sons of God. He has no voice tonight but our voice. He has no hands but our hands. He has your hands. That's who His hands it is. He said, I am the vine, you're the branches. I hope that you'll listen to this poor voice tonight and the little still voice of the Spirit that can speak in your heart and hear Him say, it's I. Be not afraid. Will you believe? Let's bow our heads. Lord Jesus, the hours are growing late and dark. I don't know just what time you might come. I believe that you've reached your great hand out and stopped time, just held it a little while. Science said a few years ago it was 3 minutes until midnight. You said in your own word, when you see these things begin to come to pass, Israel restoring, the fig tree putting forth its bud. Israel is a nation now. The six-point star of David, the oldest flag in the world, hasn't flown for 2,500 years, waves over to Israel tonight. Israel restoring. She's got her own money, her own army. She's a nation. Thousands returning, saying, where is that Messiah? What an opportunity now we have. Said, let us see Him do the sign of a prophet. If we can see Him do the sign of the prophet, then we'll know that's Messiah, that He was Messiah. He promised it. Oh God, as the Gentiles are getting their last call, may they hear the voice of God and I say, it is I. Be not afraid. Lord, I'm tired. I'm so tired I can hardly stand here. I pray that you'll do something special for us tonight. Grant, Lord, do something just the way you did it. Pick up a testimony here after 1,900 years that these apostles and disciples of this church is tonight might go away from here with the same kind of testimony they could say tomorrow. We know that our Lord is risen from the dead. He saved us from sin. He gave us the Holy Spirit. He used our lips to speak words that we not don't know what we're talking about. We see Him speak to our brother in a spirit of prophecy to bring the last sign that was promised to the church. We believe now, Lord. Help us now to get our sleeves rolled up, as it were, to say. Help us to dig into it. May every Christian in every neighborhood grant it, Lord. May every sick person in the chair, every spirit of the devil that's caught these Christians, May these Christians be in such unity and one accord that there will not be a feeble person among us tonight. And the service is over. Grant it, Lord. Show yourself alive tonight, Lord, as I leave this city. Your spirit will not leave. It'll stay here until it brings back the body of our Lord Jesus. Bless my brethren, Lord. Bless my sisters and these young men and women at the crossroads of life. May they make their decision tonight to serve you. Granted, may all sick people realize and know from their heart that the Scriptures has predicted this hour. And this hour has arrived at Grand Prairie, which we as your ministers all agree that we're in the last days and these things should be. Now, Father, won't you move on the scene for a few moments and prove that you're here. I've given a testimony of you. Now, Lord, you come testify that I've told the truth. And we'll believe you, Lord, with all of our heart. And every person in here will be healed, saved, for the glory of God. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. I told my son I'd be finished tonight at 9:30, and 10 minutes till 10 now. Yeah, I just talked so long. Where's he at? I forgot. Brother Fred, did they give out these prayer cards? I told him to come down and give out prayer cards. I didn't know whether he did it or not. And I was in prayer when they come after me tonight, and I didn't think to ask them. But you give out prayer cards. How many's out? What letters? What was to give out first? A first. Where did we start at the other night? One? All right, let's take some B's. Just get a few up here. We'll go pray for every one of them. Let's start the B's now. Because the ones probably was here to see it before. The B's are the new ones. How many did you get in the line that night? 13. 14. Well, let's take 15 out of the B's tonight. Let's see, let's start from then. Let's see, 85, 90, 95, 100. Let's start from 85. Who has prayer card B, 85? Raise up your hand. A man by, there's two hands up. B, 85. Is that yours, sir? Come here. B, 86. Who has prayer card B, 86? This lady here, would you stand right over here? 87. B 87. Would you raise your hand, please, so we know who you are? 87. What to say? 85. This is 86 here, I think. 87. That's 9. 86. Prayer card B 86. You have, that's the same as it is there. If he's the same high priest. Isn't that right? Now you believe. Every one of you now, be real reverent. Don't move around. Just believe. Now. Oh, brother. Now you're there. Brother, this is it. Now, if anybody's got a doubt that this is not God, then you come here and take my place. Come here and go down this prayer line. Let the Holy Spirit speak to you. Got a better way of doing it? Let me know. Yeah, certainly be thankful. Now, every one of these people in this prayer line, as far as I know, I do not know you. You're Canadians up here, and I'm from down the state. And if I do not know you, each one of you in this prayer line, raise up your hands. If I do not know you, everyone. How many out in the audience knows that I do not know you? Raise up your hands. Know nothing about you. Everybody, as far as I can see. I know Brother Evans' two daughters sitting right here on the seat here. And outside of that, that's the only one that I can see that I know. Yes, your sister Evans and brother and sister Dow, right here. Right here. Yes. All right. I just be real reverent. Now, you've heard me testify from the Scripture and take apostolic testimony meeting. If those apostles testifying, and of course, that was a drama, but exactly everything I said was scriptural. Do you believe that? What? It was scriptural. But in the form of a drama. Now, if he is just a historical God, then he died and it's all over. And we can, you people up here in the north, you know that you cannot, a man cannot get warm by a painted fire. If a man was freezing to death, you took him over and show him a great picture of a big fine red fire that burned one time, he cannot get warm by a painted fire. Neither can we be saved by a historical God. We cannot have the joy of a Pentecostal fire unless it's the same fire today. We cannot serve a historical God, and what good is it to you, the God of, that was in Christ, if he isn't the same God today that he promised to be? That's scriptural, friend. Now, shake yourself just a little bit. Don't be emotional, but just wake yourself up for a second. Because that's the truth. Then, here we are, with my hands before God, my Bible here, that you're strangers to me. And this prayer line, I don't know one of them. Never seen them in my life. The only reason they're standing here is somebody come down, the boy, and had a bunch of cards and mixed them up and give somebody a prayer card. And we come down tonight and they said, well, I'll call from a certain number. You call from some other number. You don't even have to have a number. You don't even have to have a prayer card. Just sit there and say, God, I believe that the Bible is right, and I believe that you are the high priest, and I believe we're living in the last days, and this man doesn't know me, and I'm sick. Let him tell me what's wrong with me. Let him speak to me like he did the woman and find out what takes place. He doesn't do it, then I'm an imposter, and the Bible tells a lie. And that's impossible for the Bible to tell a lie. I could be an imposter, but it's impossible for the Bible to tell a lie. But if the Bible backs up what I said, then I'm not an imposter. I'm a witness of his resurrection. And you can be the same. Now, isn't this glorious? Find out, where's another religion in the world? Go get the Buddha and Mohammed. Let's see if he's alive. If our Christ is alive. Go get the creeds. See if it'll work. It doesn't. It won't bring salvation. It won't bring the supernatural. If God Almighty, if the Holy Spirit would come right now and reveal one thing, just one thing, that would be as great a miracle as could happen. Exactly right. Because it's supernatural. Who could figure that out? Who could figure out how that a man, two people not knowing each other, never met in life, and yet a spirit comes down and reveals the very things that they're doing and thinking and what they have done, what they will do, and never fail? It's got to be God. It can't be nothing else. So you see, I swear it, know it, and you know it, that man cannot do those things. It takes God. So if he proves it one time that it's truth, then you all are to rejoice and be happy. And remember, it's to you also. Will you do it? Will you accept this Jesus that I've been telling you about as your healer? If you'll do it. God grant it. Now, Heavenly Father, this is as far as I can go, Lord. I can only say what the Word said. It takes you to perform the work. Here's your servants and ministers, godly men. There's godly women, servants sitting everywhere, sick and afflicted. If you were standing here with this suit on that you gave me, you could do no more for them. If they come up and said, Lord, will you heal me? Why, you'd say, my child, I did that 1900 years ago when I was striped for your healing. Believest thou this? They'd say, yea, Lord, but how do I know it's you? Then you'd show that you was the Christ. You could show them, do something that would prove to them that you was the Christ, not with nail scars in your hand, because anyone could impersonate that. But the supernatural is to go down into that person's life and know what they're doing and what they're here for. Then we know it's your spirit, you great vine moving in your branches. Let it be so tonight again, Lord. Honor your word. Forgive us of our sins, as we have forgiven those who sinned against us. Give us sweetness of spirit, and may the Holy Spirit now come right quickly and confirm the word, that every person in here might know that the Son of God is not dead, but has risen from the dead and is alive after 1900 years and alive forevermore. Through Jesus Christ's name I ask it. Amen. Now, just keep your attention. Just pray. And, all right? Is the man? All right? Now, I want you, each one, everybody, be alert. Be alert. Be praying, saying, Lord, I'm suffering with such and such. Let Brother Branham just turn to me. I know he don't know me, he don't know what's wrong with me. But if you just speak to him, I know I've touched you. Now, you could touch me all night and be like touching that desk and be nothing to it. But you just touch him one time. See what happens. Your faith touches. I hear the man. It happens to be. If I can get somebody up here before me first, you see, because after speaking and so forth, then I talk to him. It's like Jesus did the woman at the well until he found what her trouble was and then told her. And she said, well, that was right. And see, now that's the way it is to this man. Now, we do not know one another, do we, sir? You and I just want you to move right over here so I can get you, just so I can not look at that prayer line. And looking this way, there sometimes the Spirit leads and some other great high faith that goes to them. I'd like to talk to you first. Now, we are two different people, two men that's met for our first time in life. That is true, isn't it? All right. Now, if there's something, I have no idea what's wrong. I know not. Then if I could help you to be well, or you might have domestic trouble, you might have financial troubles, you might be sick, you might have cancer, you might have tumor, you might have TB. I don't know. See, I have no idea. But if I could help you and then would not do it, I'd better leave the platform. I'd be a hypocrite. I wouldn't be worthy to stand back here. But if Jesus was standing here and you'd ask him to help you, and you he would grant it for you. Now, if you want to know it was him, any man could have nail scars in his hands and prints on his forehead, but a spirit. See, because if he was standing here, the millennium would be on. He'll never come to earth again until he meets the church in the air. We're caught up with him and meet him in the air. Then he returns with his church. So he could not be here on earth that way. Only his spirit in his church. Now, you believe, now the angel of the Lord told me, as you probably read my book, I don't know, but you read it, all right? Remember up the mill that night when he talked to me and he said, if you can get the people to believe you and then be sincere when you pray, there's nothing will stand before your prayer. I said, they won't believe me. I have no education. He said, as Moses is given two signs for a vindication, so are you. He said, first you'll take the people's hands, then you'll know what's going on. After that, if you'll be sincere, it'll come to pass that you'll know the very thoughts of their heart. And said, they'll have to believe it. How many remembers that prophesied when I showed the first time or years ago, told you it wouldn't come to pass? Now see if it did or not. You just look on me. If John, Peter and John passed through the gate, and the man was crippled, said, look on us. And they looked on him. Why, he's trying to get his attention. That's the reason Jesus said to the woman, bring me a drink. Keep your spirit inside of that body. That's what I'm dealing with, is the spirit in you. Now, I don't know you, but my spirit, you don't know me, but God knows both of us. So therefore, it'll have to take something in me to tell you. And then you'll know whether it's the truth or not. If it's the truth, well, then it comes from God. If it is the truth, it isn't God. That's logical, isn't it? You're not here for yourself. You're here for somebody else. That's a woman. It's your wife. And she's not here. You believe God can tell me what's wrong with her? Would you believe in him? He's had a stroke. That is lying. You believe she's going to be well now? That spirit is on you? When you go to her, lay your hands on her. In the name of the Lord Jesus, don't doubt. She'll get out of it. Go now and do it. God bless you. Do you believe? You believe? Ask the man if those things were right. Just have faith. Now be real reverent. Reverent. Just as long as I can stand. We are strangers to each other. I've never seen you in my life. You're younger than I. I have just never seen you. But perhaps that woman that met our Lord at the well that time, she was probably younger than you were. And that's their first time meeting. Here we meet, just like they did. Now you're a human being. I'm a human being. I don't know you, you don't know me. But by being Christian, then we have a Father who knows both of us. If He can tell me something that you're here for, or something that you have done, something that you ought not have done, if He can tell you what has been, surely you can believe what He says will come will be right, if He tells you what has been. Now, if I come here and said, God, give me a gift of healing, I'll lay my hands up on you, glory to God, be healed. You can believe that. That could be true. And that's right. I believe that with all, the Bible says so. But now, let's go beyond that. We've had that day. Let's go beyond that. And now, what if He stands here now and can tell you what you are, what you're wanting, and the desires of your heart, and the secret of your heart, and the things in your life that you need or ought not have done? If they're not under the blood, He will expose them. Now, because if they're under the blood, they're in the sea of forgetfulness. No man can dig those up. Yeah. You are a Christian. The vibration of your spirit, that's what I call it. I don't know, the way. You feel welcome. You believe me. You do that. As soon as you walked up, I knew that. You could have been a deceiver. Walk up here, then what would have happened? You've heard of what happened on them. Many lay in paralyzed night, many in the grave for that. We're not playing church. We're serving a God. The real nerve. God had a lot on your mind, a rough life. Your backline. A lot of weary and trouble. You also suffer with a rupture. Now, do you believe me to be His prophet or His servant? And you think that was a gift? Wait a minute, wait a minute. She's a very fine contact to God, this little lady. I don't know what I told you. Whatever what it was the truth. Is that right? Now, if we have to stand with this woman just now, then she can talk to someone, a real fine spirit. Yes? Nervousness. That's right. And a nervous condition. And Satan bothers you about it. Says you're going to lose your mind and everything that's here. He's lying. Yeah, rupture. I see that. Waiting for an operation. But that you have also a varicose vein in your limb. That is right. Then you've got somebody on your heart. That person is here. Your husband. You think if God can tell me what's wrong with your husband, would you believe it? His back. That's right. There's something else. I see a child appear. You're praying and interested in a child. There's something wrong with that child. It's because it doesn't learn very well. That is true. Thus saith the Lord. Those things true? Do you accept it all as a deliverance ticket from God for you? Go, and it'll be just as you have believed. God will with you. You have believed? Have faith. Have faith. I do not know you. We're strangers to each other. Ma'am, you met me before. You know me. I don't know you. See, a lot of people know me just coming to meetings and being places like that. But I never know. Know nothing about you. You believe me to be your servant? I believe that. You got a rush. That's what's wrong with you. You're not from this city either. But Alberta, place called Easton. That's right. You believe God can tell me who you are? Would that help you? Mrs. Brown? I go and he may well. God bless you. You believe? You believe? You believe God can reveal to me what's your trouble? You're seriously, you're facing an operation, so the doctor said. Brother Strong Man, it's a female trouble, and you don't believe in operation. That's why you come to me to pray for you. And you thought within your heart when you prayed, if you could get on this platform, I lay my hands on you, you wouldn't need the operation. If that's your prayer, raise your hand. Say, God, I know what you ask God. Come here. In the name of Jesus Christ, may her desire be granted. Amen. Go on down. Believe. Ah, you're strangers to me. You believe it? God can tell me what's your trouble? Think your shoulder will get all right? What'd you touch? It'll be all right now. I've seen a much larger woman appear here. You're praying. All right? Your faith saves you now. What did she touch? A little lady sitting with a black hat on looking at me. Yes, you. Your stomach trouble has left you now. Go eat your supper. Jesus Christ makes you well. Fall over now. Go eat. Had a peptic condition in your stomach. Fall over. What about them headaches sitting back there, young lady? Believe God can heal headaches and make you well? Yes. You had more faith than you thought you did, didn't you? Your headaches will stop now. Frankly, you don't have it now. What did she touch? Just think, what did she touch? She touched the high priest. That lady sitting way back in the back with arthritis there. You believe that God will make you well back there? That woman with glasses on. I don't know. You've never seen you in my life, but you're sitting back there praying. If that's so, raise up to your feet. God bless you. You'll never be crippled with it. I challenge you to believe me. I don't know these people. I've never seen them. But my Lord knows them. The man sitting, that second one back in the end, back there suffering his stomach trouble. You believe that God will make you well? Accept it? God bless you. You have a prayer card? You have a prayer card? You do? You won't need it. God can cure diabetes, can he? All right. Go believe me. Just have faith. He heals nervousness too. Don't you believe that? Thank you, Lord. Just believe with all your heart. Come. He heals arthritis. Do you believe that? Then you keep on going. Just a minute. Something happened. Come on. Of course, we see you're walking on a cane. I won't mention that. But your diabetes and heart trouble, you believe that God will make it well and then make you heal you? You believe it?
God
will heal you? Keep moving on and saying, thank you, Lord. Go on, be well. Say, thank you, Lord. You believe everybody? Just have faith. Don't doubt. Believe with all your heart. What about that gallbladder trouble sitting there against the wall? You're looking so sincere. I don't know you, do I? We're strangers to one another. But that's what your trouble. That is right, isn't it? Are we strangers to one another? Raise up your hand. Was that your trouble? All right, sir. You're sitting there praying, wanting God to touch you. You touched him, and he touched me. Now, Clarence, Mr. Ruin, you can go home and be well.
God makes you well.
That's your name, isn't it? That's right. Raise up your hand. I've never seen you. You believe? How many of you believe with all your heart? Why is Christ here, friends? I want to show you something. My brethren here is man of God. They have just as much right to pray for the sick as I do. Come here, brethren. Come here. Get yourself on each side and make a double line right on here. I want you to see, when I'm gone, don't have to wait for me to come back. Here's man of God. Praise for the sick too. Just make a double line right along here. Come out on both sides with me. Don't want to leave a congregation thinking it's just some evangelist has to come by and pray for the sick. I want to show you that God will heal the sick through these men's prayers. How many of you got prayer cards? Raise up your hand. Try to take your numbers, all the A's first. Line up right over here. Wait, where did we leave off? Okay, I get it. All right, before we get, just a moment, if you don't, we'll get all mixed up. Let these people over here that's got prayer card A get in the line. Well, A and B, get in the line over here, this section over here. Line that up over here, A and B. On that section only now. Just a moment. Just get that side over there. We'll get them every one. Just a moment now, we'll get every one. See, we'll get every one. All on this side with A and B. Right. Now, we have to take these here back around the other way when we get them, you see. We have to get one side at a time. All with A and B, line up on this side. All right? Now, as soon as this side gets through, let this middle row come through on that side. After they get cleared out, and as soon as they get cleared out, let this side come through. Everybody that will believe and will pass through here with all faith in God, are you afraid? Be not afraid, it is I, said the Lord Jesus. Don't you believe it's Him? How many believe it's Him? Oh, look, if He's here just because that He made me a seer, He made these men ministers. See, they've got the same spirit that I have. Same God, same Holy Ghost, same charge before God to pray for the sick. Same hand, same spirit. They're anointed in the same amount. We're going to stand here together and pray for each one of you as you pass through, laying our hands upon you. And when you pass through here, you act like that you got healed. You go through here saying, thank you, Lord, and go back out there and watch your stomach troubles and all these other things leave you. Will you believe it? Let's pray now together as we bow our heads. Lord Jesus, Thou art here. You proved Yourself here, Lord, all around on the building, telling the people, calling them. And You sent Your servants, Lord, and I want this people here to know that Your servants, they don't have to wait for some special person to come through, some special evangelist. Oh God, they can go right and call their pastor. They are Your servants. And here they are when I call for them like real soldiers stood out before the congregation. They're believers. They're ready, anointed, to lay their hands upon the sick. God Almighty, who raised up Jesus, who's our Savior, who stands in our midst tonight. Anoint us, Lord. Anoint us with Your Holy Spirit, that when we lay hands upon these people, may the blessings of God come on them, and may every one of them be healed. Grant it, Lord. We start them through here and pray for them in the name of Jesus Christ. And Satan, we have a word for you. We want to tell you that you've deceived the people as long as you're going to. You have no legal right to hold them. Jesus Christ took every right you had when He rose up from the dead. He triumphed over you. And you're nothing but a bluff. And He's here tonight to call your bluff and expose you and tell you who you are. Amen. And you can't hold this audience any longer. We take this audience, this sick people here, God's children, in the name of Jesus Christ, to cast you away from them. And you'll have to leave them. We're going to lay our hands upon them to fulfill the Word of God. When they go through here, their hearts will be full of glory of God and shall go off the earth praising God. They shall be healed and there will be a revival. Oh, God, and in the name of Jesus Christ, may it be so, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Now, is the congregation with their heads bowed? If you cannot pray, sing while somebody leads the singing. Don't you love him? Isn't he wonderful? Oh, this is to me like heaven. Can you? Oh, I'm not emotional. Not I don't think to excess, but I just feel a real sweet feeling, just like if the Heavenly Father would say, "It was well done." Everybody prayed for it. How many believe you're going to be well now? Raise your hand. Everyone. Look, the Spirit of God, through the meeting, coming right along, that's exactly what he said. There's only one thing to keep it from it. If you just don't believe it, it won't happen. If you do believe it, it has to happen. It's already finished. See? It's a finished work. Oh, isn't he wonderful? Oh, I just love him. Just bow our heads a moment. Heavenly Father, I know there's such in the audience one who is Satan has bound, and he's trying to hold the woman. God grant that he'll leave her, a lovely person. Why shouldn't she be free? I pray that you'll grant it, Father. Through Jesus, our Son, we ask it. Amen. Is there a sinner here who would like to accept Christ as their Savior? in the presence of God now would just stand and say, I accept him as my Savior? Would there be that one here who is backslidden and would like to come back to God right now under the anointing of the Holy Spirit? God bless you, son. God grant it to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, I give you the desire of your heart. Return now to the house of God, calling upon his name and live true to him. Pastor, I sure appreciate this fine fellowship. Why didn't you ask? That's the pastor. Let his congregation go through and not ask for himself. That blood will stop. Bless you, brother. Just caught his hand here, a vibration running. Could have run him to a cancer. He'll be all right now. Never said a word to me about it. Never mentioned it. I just caught it when it stuck my hand. God bless you, Pastor. God bless you, congregation. Till we meet, till we meet, till we meet at Jesus. God bless you, my brother. God bless you, brother. Till we God bless you, brother. See you, dog. Till we meet, God is with you. God be with you. Till we meet again. As I give you your pastor, let's bow our heads and sing it softly. Till we meet. May the God of heaven ever be with you, ever grace you. I'll be praying for you. You pray for me until we meet. Meet where? At Jesus' feet. Till we meet. God bless you, family.